And then start to cook.
We're gonna make like a little roux. We're gonna just start with some butter and some flour.
So we have some butter here, but you don't need all of that, I'm sure.
No.
Flour.
And this is a little flour, just
a
little bit.
I'm taking care of the Guinness.
Pop that, baby.
Oh, good.
I'm gonna stir this around and I'm gonna...
So the roux stays blonde, I mean white?
I'm gonna give it a little bit of color. While I'm doing this, do you wanna slice up the bread for me? Kind of thick, like an inch thick. It is really fun to give you direction in the kitchen. I think that when you cook with someone else who loves to cook and who, you know, is also comfortable in the kitchen, there's just an easiness that comes with wanting to help each other and anticipating each other's next moves.
I have the easy job, actually.
Yeah, I'll just tell you what to do. It was liberating to boss Eric prepare around. Oh, good.
This is a good thickness?
Yeah, that's great. And then brush it with a little bit of olive oil and you can toast it.
Now, when you come to New York, you work at Vong and at Le Cirque.
And at Le Cirque. I went to Le Cirque first.
When you're at Le Cirque, it's your first experience in a big team, a big brigade.
Oh, yes.
Are you many ladies in the kitchen or
no.
you alone?
I was alone.
How the team reacts to you?
It was an ass whooping is what it was. As it should be, as it should be. I mean, I know because I've talked to you about your early years.
Yes.
You get your ass kicked, and that's why you're there in the first place. It was the younger cooks on the line who I found were the toughest.
The ones who were responsible of a station on the line.
I don't know if it was because I was a woman or because they just wanted to throw me into the fire, so to speak.
It's a men's world.
It absolutely
when
is.
When I grew up and started also in La Tour d'Argent in Paris,
right?
it was no ladies. One day we have an American lady, and she's beautiful, and she comes to our kitchen in training. Her name was Jane. I had never seen a woman in a kitchen before. And one of the line cooks goes to her and says, what's your name? And start to be flirty and kind of condescending. And she said, je suis Jane.
Right.
And he said, Tarzan. And she looked at him and she said, cheetah.
See, I had two older brothers growing up. I got beaten up all the time. God, I can play with the boys.
That's nice. You're tough to them?
I tried to be. I tried to just hold my ground. And more than anything, I just wanted to show them that I could work hard, right? That's all you want to do is put your head down.
Do you have to work harder?
To prove myself a little bit. But there's also certain things that in a kitchen I couldn't do. I'm not as strong as a 23-year-old boy.
You mean physically?
Physically. It is a truth that today, we've come a long way, but there are still far fewer women working in professional kitchens than men. Anything I can do to encourage women to be in this industry, the more of us, the better. You know, after a while, I felt like they
adopted you.
Appreciated me. But it was just a different dynamic. It was a rowdier kitchen, but the guys were great. It was a lot of fun.
It's really good.
Wow. So excited. So,
I was a bit scared when I saw the
beer.
It
sounds scary.
Yeah, the beer, the cheese, I was like, oh my God, where are we going? I didn't even know that people make a roux with beer and potentially eat it on the toast. I had absolutely no clue. Very good.
Put the cheese in, put it right in the sauce. See, I'm gonna whisk it and now it starts to get really thick because there's that roux at the bottom and then the cheese is melting and you wanna just make sure it all sort of emulsifies together.
Together, right? After that adventure to Le Cirque.
It was a tough kitchen. But the turning point was that I had to make family meal one day at Le Cirque. It was breakfast.
Eggs again.
And I made eggs.
Yes.
And I made really good, like beautiful, soft, fluffy scrambled eggs. And I think they all were really, really appreciative. And they were like, oh, thanks, Caleb. Those are great.
So what we call family meal in a restaurant is basically the meal that is served to the employees.
You know that you're often cooking for the chefs themselves. And you want it to be good if you're the one charged with it.
If you cannot do that job properly, how can we trust you to cook for the clients?
You know, I knew that I was doing all of this because I didn't want to stay in kitchens. I needed the foundation, but I ultimately knew I wanted to write.
You didn't want to become a chef.
No, I knew that already. And I knew that most food writers had never spent time in kitchens before. You want to stir this for a sec? Yeah. And I'm going to do a couple things here. You're working late hours. All my girlfriends didn't keep the same hours as me. I would get home at 1 o'clock in the morning, as a young cook does. That's usually the time when all the young cooks get in a lot of trouble. That's when they're out drinking. So instead, I read a lot. Someone gave me a book that sort of changed my life. It was a book called The Man Who Ate Everything.
Oh, from Jeffrey Steingarten, yeah.
Who writes for Vogue.
Great writer, of course.
He's one of the greatest food writers of our time. And in reading the book, I thought, oh my God, this is it. This is the job I've been waiting to find, but didn't know existed.
That was destiny.
It was destiny. And he's looking for a new assistant. I worked for him for 2 years. I did everything I thought and hoped I would do. I wrote and I edited and I did research and I did recipe testing. I was still cooking and working with food, testing recipes.
In touch with it.
Exactly. He introduced me to a million people. Everyone from Harold McGee to Pierre Hermé to really like icons, Alice Waters. Mm. And one of the people he introduced me to was Danielle. I think they sort of took pity on me because they knew how hard I was working.
Let's talk about Daniel.
Yes. I went to work for him in the offices, doing PR, marketing. They were just starting to expand. I'm just gonna pour this right on top.
So the bread's gonna drink it a little bit?
Yes. And it might go through. And
it's great, though.
Yeah. I'm gonna put these in the oven and broil it for just a few minutes.
Okay, I keep an eye on it.
Please do, that's your job.
Yes. So you're working in the office at Daniel.
And it actually ended up being the perfect amalgamation of my kitchen knowledge and the work I'd done with Jeffrey. And so it was a magical place to
and
work.
And you're still learning.
I was learning a ton. I learned about the business of restaurants. Huge eye-opener,
so that
right?
will help you to go then to food and wine.
And that's exactly what I did. And we're gonna leave it for like 15 seconds and then it's good.
15 seconds? You really talk like a chef.
I'm just saying, that's all it needs is 15 seconds.
She's in control and this dish is exactly her vision.
I have a lot of experience bossing people around. I'm very good at it. I take pride in that skill. Take out the bread,
you're the
wash
chef.
Your
I'm
hands.
The chef now. Oh, it looks good. It's bubbling on top.
Yeah,
okay.
That's exactly what you want. Eric is a good sous chef. He's used to the one who has to anticipate everything and manage and delegate. And so I think he felt a lot of freedom in just waiting for instructions.
Suddenly you end up on the Aspen Food and Wine Festival.
And I took on the festival about a year into my job.
The Food and Wine Festival is one of the first big festivals.
We just celebrated our 30th anniversary. And Aspen is still pretty small.
Very intimate.
And very
mean.
Intimate. So you really are sort of rubbing elbows with all the chefs that are
so
there.
So you think people go because they have access to the chefs?
I also think that the world of food has grown, so people's interest and their knowledge is so much stronger
than 20
now
years
than
ago.
20 years ago.
You always learn something. You never leave one of those festivals empty-handed.
It's become not only a great place for consumers to learn about chefs and meet chefs, but for chefs to get together and, you know, let down their hair, so to speak. It's almost like these miniature think tanks they become, but with a lot more booze.
Oh,
oh no, I'm gonna get it. It's slippery. Hold on, I don't want to break the yolk.
Let me do it.
No. I'm letting you do it.
I love it.
It would totally defeat the purpose.
I was very amused by the fact that she was like, no. We can talk, but it's very important to make that dish delicious. You're really the boss and in control. I love it.
We can eat these, by the way.
Why don't we move and have the Bloody Mary?
Perfect.
Yes.
You have Top Chef just desserts.
Basically, they were saying to me, Gail, we'd like you to eat dessert all day long. We're just gonna give you donuts and cupcakes and ice cream sundaes, and you can just eat them all day long, and we'll put a camera on you. And we'll bring a bunch of your friends in, and you can all do it together.